We want to see if plant-based meat versus red meat makes a difference for health. Here's the ingredients in dog food, and here's the ingredients in plant-based meat. Basically, they're the same, so you're eating dog food.
Love them or hate them, meat alternatives have become a reality. Lab-grown meat was recently approved for sale in the U.S. for the first time ever, and realistic plant-based burgers have been around for a couple of years now. So it's crucial to test the health effect of these products. Are imitation meats healthier than real meat because they're made from plants? Or are they unhealthy because they're processed? Both of these views are often voiced, but what is much less often brought up is what scientific evidence we have on this question. Professor Christopher Gardner and his team at Stanford have investigated this question, and I recently had the chance to discuss it with him.
Yeah, I wanted to make sure we touch on imitation meats because it's a very topical issue. And yeah. We have so little evidence on it, so little hard evidence. And you guys have done what is one of the few studies trying to look at the effect, health effect of these imitation meats. Can you go over the takeaways from swap meat?
Yeah. It was Beyond Meat that funded this. So I'm an industry shill. Let's just put that on the table right now. So if you listen to Marion Nessel, I was influenced by my funder. Totally fair. Now, if I can just go back for a minute to say where I kind of got started is I was very interested in these plant alternative meats being introduced, thinking, you know, I really want them to eat lentils, but I've wanted them to eat lentils for decades and they're not eating lentils. They're still eating red meat. So maybe I'll be open-minded. And I opened the New York Times and on three different occasions, there's a full page ad slamming the fake meats saying, okay, here's the ingredients in dog food and here's the ingredients in plant-based meat. Basically, they're the same. So you're eating dog food. It's like, that's a ridiculous statement. No, it's not dog food. Okay. And so part of it was, oh, but it's better for the planet. And there's lots of reasons to say that. And I actually totally support that. And I think the data are strong. And the other side said, ah, the saturated fat is going to raise your LDL from the coconut fat. The high sodium is going to raise your blood pressure. And because of Kevin Hall's study, ultra processed food leads to weight gain. So you're going to gain weight. And I thought, this is my superpower. I feed and bleed people for a living. I could do this. Let's see. Should I apply to the NIH and wait to get rejected 10 or 12 times? Plus, I'd have to get this meat. Okay, so I get a hold of Ethan Brown and we meet and he says, yeah, I would fund that study. And so gave it as a gift. So he had no, he doesn't get to look at the data or the design or anything like that. In my own self-defense, if you can tell I'm defensive here, we had a data lockdown. We had a third-party statistician. We took pre-approved, you know, statistical plans submitted to the NIH. It's listed on ct.gov. So I did all the right things.
This is great. Just sorry to stop you because we get so much resistance, and I think to some extent it's legitimate. But people are very, very wary of industry funding and any type of financial bias. So yeah, this is great giving the background of how these studies are done. People think the industry goes in and, you know, cooks the books and tells you what to publish. So this is excellent, kind of explaining what they do and don't control and how this is generally managed.
And I will say, I on Twitter defended our paper when it came out saying that here's actually a list of six null findings that I've published in the past from industry funded studies. I got null findings and I published them because that's what I found. I'm supposed to publish whichever way it goes. Anyway, this is a little fun to get into the details. This is another dose issue. What would the dose be? So we want to see if plant-based meat versus red meat makes a difference for health. Should it be a burger a week? No, that's not enough perturbation. A burger a day. What percent of calories would that be? That'd be like 10% of calories. 90% of the calories would be the same. How about two servings a day? That sounds like you're pushing it. So what? That's like 25% of calories a day. 75% would be your regular calories. Okay, I don't think more than two servings a day would be realistic or we could get a buy-in, but I think less than two servings a day. And how long should we do this? So I hope your listeners know that for a lot of basic cardiometabolic things, 2 weeks is often enough to change lipids, blood pressure. If you have one steady diet and you have a stable blood pressure, cholesterol, glucose reading, and you go to another stable diet, if you were to track them every day after 2 weeks, whatever the change was going to happen would plateau. So we made them 8-week phases, and we made them a crossover, so you'd be your own control. And so we had 36 people do plant or animal in opposite order, and there was no lentil burger option. The question here was, and it's very key, how do plant meats do instead of what? Instead of red meat. That's what they're being made to replace. This, the target audience of Beyond Meat is not vegetarians. The target audience is people who are eating red meat and weren't really ever thinking of giving it up unless something looks and tastes and smells the same. And I think it's a fascinating market approach. Seems to be working up to a point at least. So anyway, we had two servings of red meat, two servings of Beyond Meat. And the red meat, by the way, we went to San Francisco. We didn't get McDonald's hamburgers or fast food. We went and got regenerative farming, organic, pasture-raised meat. So we're seeking equipoise here. We're trying to do a high-quality plant-based alternative meat, a high-quality red meat. And it was in the form of burgers, ground beef, chicken, and sausages. So Beyond Meat had parallels to all of those. So you could have some variety while you're eating. It would be horribly two burgers a day for 8 weeks. So they had that kind of variety, and it adherence was very good. So they got right about a little more than two servings a day on average. And we took blood before and after. Trimethylamine oxide, which is an emerging risk factor, was lower in the plants. LDL cholesterol was lower despite the coconut fat and saturated fat, which it has, but it's still lower than the meat in saturated fat. And the plant meat has fiber, and red meat has no fiber whatsoever. And then a very bizarre finding that actually was the most statistically significant, but I need to put some caveats here. On the plant meat, they were a pound or two lower, and it was highly statistically significant, but it's not clinically relevant, I don't think. And for those of your listeners who may not realize this, one of the ways to get a big statistically significant difference is to get a whopping big difference between A and B. And the other one is every single person is a little bit lighter. Like there's very little variability. They almost all of them were a pound or two lighter, which I don't think is clinically relevant, but that was actually the most statistically significant finding of the three. So three benefits for plant meat: TMAO, LDL cholesterol, and weight. Nothing was better on red meat. And we measured other things. Glucose wasn't different. But importantly, blood pressure wasn't different. So people were slamming them for high sodium. And they did have sodium, but when people got red meat and like a plain beef patty, they salted it. And so by the time you looked at the salt they were getting, sodium was roughly equivalent for the two. Protein was virtually identical for the two, but one was much more plant-based protein and one was animal protein. So we have a very nice set of dietary graphics and figures and tables showing what nutrients were different. And, you know, sort of from an internal validity point, we matched them as well as we could. If they had a white bun burger for the plant-based meat, they had to do white bun for the animal. If they had a whole wheat fancy bun for one, they had to have whole wheat for the other. And if they had heirloom tomatoes on one with ketchup, it had to be heirloom and tomatoes and ketchup on the other one, but that was up to the participants. So after 8 weeks on each diet, 16 weeks total, that happened. There, a little side thing that was funny was the TMAO, the precursor to trimethylamine oxide, is carnitine or choline. And we pretty much expected that to be better on plant because the precursor for that is red meat. And they were eating red meat versus plant meat. And so when folks got the red meat first, they actually couldn't be vegetarians to be in the study, but they weren't huge red meat eaters. They were eating about one serving a day of meat. So when we put them at two servings a day of meat, their TMAO went up when they went on animal. And then as soon as we switched them to plant, it dropped and it stayed down. That was the group that did animal first. There's a group that did plant first and it dropped a little. And then they did animal and it didn't go up. Oh my God, this is actually a problem in a crossover study. In a crossover study, you assume that whichever order they go in, there's no real difference. And so you can collapse them and everybody's their own control. It's a little bit problematic when order one is different than order two, And in order to, TMAO didn't go up. So at first I was cursing the day and kicking my feet and said, crap, what am I going to do? But we actually found a couple papers where people had fed red meat or the equivalent to vegetarians and didn't get the expected rise in TMAO, with the explanation that the vegetarian diet had changed their microbiome, which is an important metabolic part of generating TMAO from choline and carnitine. And so by making them vegetarian for 8 weeks, we may have prevented the red meat from causing TMAO to go up, which leads to the silliest of all possible conclusions. So I want to make sure readers all know this, that the best way to eat red meat is to be vegetarian first. So be vegetarian, and vegetarians can go ahead and eat red meat, which obviously makes no sense at all. And probably that would have changed if we had gone out longer than 8 weeks, but it was sort of the silly conclusion that we batted around for a while.
Yeah, there's a whole debate around TMAO, whether it's just a marker or whether it actually causes anything, or it's just a correlate of disease. But yeah, clearly it associates with cardiovascular disease and with all these things. But whether it's an innocent bystander or an actual cause is a bit up for grabs. So there's some genetic data indicating that it's a marker, not a maker, but
yeah.
Yeah, there's still some debate, but probably the most surprising finding that you mentioned was the weight loss, because I think a lot of people would expect the processed food to lead to weight gain or at least stability, but to go on the ultra processed variety and lose, was it a pound or two for over 2 months, correct?
Yeah, 8 weeks. It's not a lot.
If that was sustained over time, if it was a pound or two every 8 weeks, then it would be pretty meaningful after 6 months or a year. But that to me was the most counterintuitive.
The opposite direction. Like I said, it's ultra processed, you'll gain weight. No, it was part of a whole food diet. And we asked everybody to use a whole wheat bun and heirloom tomatoes and stone ground mustard instead of whatever. You know, we asked them to eat well during this thing, but we really only had control over what we delivered, and we delivered the Beyond Meat or the red meat. So that's, just sort of wrap this up at the end of the day. One of my challenges in the kind of studies that I do, which I love to do studies with food, and food is a bitch because it's very personal and it's not a pill. So I really love the way Kevin Hall does very rigorous studies, but he makes them as generalizable as possible by using real foods in this very controlled situation. I use real foods in less of a controlled situation, but I feel like my findings are more generalizable because I can have a much larger sample size because I don't have to domicile or incarcerate them. And I really feel like the two types of studies dovetail really well. He can get a more rigorous, it's less generalizable, but he maximizes both of them, I think. And I'm trying to maximize both of them, leaning more towards generalizability, but while still being as rigorous I can with diet assessment, follow-up, adherence, retention, and attention to lots of things like that. So at the end of the day, I don't have the perfect answers, but I keep trying to address questions that the public is curious about. And you're curious enough to ask me to be on your podcast. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for being on. And we're going to change the name of the channel. It's going to be Food's a Bitch from now on. I agree with that. But yeah, thanks so much for coming on and for the time that you devote to explaining these things to the public on social media and on here. And we're lucky to have you.
So they actually just published a follow-up to that trial that we discussed. The original trial is called Swap Meat, and this follow-up that very recently came out is called Swap Meat Athlete, which is also a randomized trial, but it looked specifically at athletic performance. So they took young, healthy people and fed them three different diets: a whole food plant-based diet, a diet with plant-based imitation meats, so still plant-based but more processed, and then an omnivorous diet with red meat and chicken. And they looked at several measures of performance: running times, weightlifting, strength, push-ups, pull-ups, etc. They basically put them through the ringer, and they did not find a significant difference for any of the diets on any of those tasks. One limitation of this type of randomized trial is often duration. And in this case, it was fairly short, 1 month on each diet. So it'll be interesting in the future to see if longer trials also pan out the same way. Another caveat is the people on plant-based diets were eating less protein overall, especially those on the whole food plant-based. About 1.1 gram of protein per kilo of body weight compared to 1.3 on the imitation meat plant-based diet and almost 1.6 on the omnivore diet. So this is something that can be tailored. Depending on type of physical activity and the individual's goals, 1.1 or 1.2, that range can be completely fine. Whereas for people lifting weights and trying to maximize muscle growth, it may be advantageous to try to get closer to 1.6, which usually requires a bit more conscious planning for people on whole plant-based diets. And we covered all of this in detail before. Also in this trial, the results suggested a trend towards better performance on the omnivore diet, which didn't reach statistical significance, so we can't speculate too much. But I wonder if the trial were longer, if it would reach significance, and if matching protein across all three diet groups would bring them all level. That is what we see in general in trials of athletic performance and even muscle growth in particular, comparing plant with animal sources when protein and leucine intake are matched. So, all things to consider. Another thing they looked at in this swap meet athlete trial was body weight. In general, the people on the plant diets had lower body weight and lower body fat, even though the reported caloric intake wasn't significantly different between the three groups. Also interesting, they looked at some measures of satisfaction with the diet, including taste, and the whole food plant-based and omnivore diets scored similarly, while the imitation meat diet scored lower. Maybe they got fed up of those foods after a while, or maybe it's the perception of eating these processed foods over and over. Either way, I guess this is a personal, subjective thing, and results may vary from person to person. So that's the evidence on these products so far for people who want to know what's been figured out scientifically. Of course, for some people, the choice of which meat and which meat source to go for is going to hinge on environmental and ethical concerns, and that's fine, of course. But for those who do want to know what health data is out there, we'll keep updating you as more information emerges. The strongest health evidence is what we call outcome evidence, so actual risk of diseases in the long run, not just blood markers. So at the end of the day, that's the type of evidence we ideally base major dietary decisions on. We also made a video a while back, actually, looking at imitation meats and with an overview of the nutritional composition of these products. So check that out over here. Let me know your questions below. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week. Bye.